Yea to Life. What I am about to say is not intended for everybody. I warn you, it is intended only for those who have ears for it. For others, I would say something very different, possibly the direct opposite. And so, if you do not like what I say, if you find it uninteresting or in part unintelligible or offensive, or if, having heard my words, you are one who can forget them, then do not let yourself be overmuch disturbed by them. Do forget them. You are certainly not one of those to whom I am speaking. I am really speaking only to those who have ears for what I have to say, who have, as it seems to me, a rare kind of ear for a rare kind of music. I care about life. My concern is not for mere human existence, not for keeping breath in every scrap of humanity that is still able to drag itself around. My concern is for quality of life, and for ever grander quality. I care that there should be on this earth life that is rich and beautiful and strong and exalted. But on every hand it seems to me that such life in men is being beaten. Life is to be found, of course, only in individuals, but on every hand the individual is being overwhelmed by the mass, and in the name of the mass. Everyone is being called upon to bend the knee to the great ox god Baal, which is the human herd, and everywhere men have succumbed. They have become as alike as tin cans and toothpicks, and just about as significant. They are afraid to be different. In America, to be different is the unforgivable sin. In every child that comes into the world, it seems that life, undiscouraged, tries afresh, in the hope, as it were, that perhaps, here at last, may be one in whom it may come to complete fulfillment. But the child is hardly born before society on every side begins to crush down upon him with its pressure, until slowly the individual is tripped, trapped, caged, cowed, seduced, suffocated, or crushed into submission. Our whole social setup does it. Our homes, our schools, our churches. On every side the child is greeted with thou shalt not. There is so little reverence before the life in the child, so little effort to help the young person find out what seems true to him, what to him is most worth living and dying for. Everywhere education is a matter of something stuck on from the outside, like so much paint and plaster. Also, in every government, whether it be a dictatorship or a democracy, we have the top-heavy centralized state crushing down upon the individual with its demands. And everywhere people are coming to believe that once the government has spoken, there is no recourse left but to obey. In our industries, men by increasing millions are learning simply to take orders, to do as they're told and are compelled, if they are to exist, to let this living thing, which is their personality, be subjected for the working hours of the day to a dead and utterly alien master, the factory machine. And more, the syndicates of the press and the broadcasts of the radio are causing a large part of the people, not only of a nation, but of a whole civilized world, to be hit at the same moment with the same ideas, all of which is resulting in uniformity. And wherever you have life becoming uniform, it is a sign that it has not been strong enough to take the shape and direction which belong to it. It has been beaten. And our resistance to this overpowering influence of society has been to no small extent undermined by our very philosophy and religion. Christianity, as it has come down to us, has given us a herd ethics. The well-being of the mass is placed above the integrity of the individual. A thing called love, but which is even a denial of the highest love if it involve a betrayal of life, has been exalted above trueness. We have been exhorted to render service, to do good, and to help others, even though it be at the price of turning our backs on that farthest, rarest, and most socially significant life in us, which is contained in our own highest vision. The individual is required to subordinate himself to the mass, whose demands press in upon him so hard that he is usually left with a sick conscience if he does not stand ready to set aside not only his job and his family, but his deepest insights, his surest convictions, in order to become an effective instrument for the welfare of the greatest number. The well and the capable are given to believe that they have spent their years most worthily if they have spent them on the sick and the inferior. The strong are told it is their duty to load themselves down with the burdens of the weak. The tall are called upon in the name of love to stoop low and make themselves small that they may be heard by little people with deaf ears. The swift are asked to take pity and to accept the pace of the slow that they may be helpful to cripples. And the result is a frightful leveling of life, mediocrity of life, and denial of life. The result is that the life in people of exceptional possibilities is lost. They are prevented from making the advancement of life for mankind their greatest gift, which is their own true selves. And wherever an individual fails of his fulfillment, there is a dead cell in the body of society. And yet, this is happening on every side. And it is happening in large part because men have so long been taught that it is more important to be loving than to be true. People today have almost no sense of what is in them. It is almost impossible to find anyone who knows what he really wants to do and who is doing it. Everywhere people are saying not what they really believe, but what they have been taught they ought to believe. They are living at second hand. They do not what they themselves see, but what somebody else says. Everywhere life is starched and collared. Everywhere men are dying without ever having really lived. In our so-called virtue especially, there is no leap, no spontaneity, no elemental force, no blood, no joy. In other words, life is everywhere tamed, weak, falsified, uniform, mediocre, good, that is, beaten, if not dead. But I care about life. I care that there should be on this earth life that is rich, beautiful, strong, and exalted. I am looking for him who knows what it is to plumb deep, deep, deep down until he comes to that which he himself wants, only, mark you, wants most deeply, and who will accept this and avow it and rest in it as our forefathers were taught to rest in the will of God. Who at last, with his head thrown back, without fear, without shame, without apology, without explanation, will stand forth before the world his simple, naked self. I am looking for him who has got down to that most unappeasable yearning in his being, to that in him which is such that so long as everything else comes to him, but this comes to him not, then everything that does come to him turns to dust in his hands and ashes in his mouth. To that life in him which is such that once he does find it and does yield himself to it utterly, then though everything else is taken away from him, though he has to go cold and hungry and alone, though he knows no human being on this earth into whose eyes he can look and find understanding, though everything he has sweated bloody sweat for, men bring to what they call failure, and his very life they bring to what they call death, he shall yet be able to go his way softly singing in his heart. To do this is to live, and to fail to do this, no matter how good the reason for the failure may be, is to do what most men do, to die without ever having really lived at all.